all names in this tale, except for my childhood nickname of Tommy, have been changed because, well, you know how high school was. It was 1964, and goodness knows, it was a whole different world than today, almost a half century ago. Time passes so quickly. "Stop, Tommy! You're gonna kill him!" I was beating the stuff out of Fred as hard as I could, sitting on his chest and pummeling his face. Stevie pulled at my shoulders, pleading for me to stop. But the harder he pulled, the fiercer I felt motivated to teach this bully a lesson. But Stevie got a hold of me from behind, locking his hands together across my chest, and dug his feet into the ground, flinging us backward and falling sideways beside the inert shape of Big Fred. Stevie and I just looked at each other, breathing heavily after the exertion we had just expended. Then we looked back at Fred, sprawled back on his back, with his messed up face, displaying blood matching that which was on his button-down yellow Oxford shirt. As we knelt beside him, I was glad that he was still breathing, though just barely. As a kid, I was called Tommy, and not very athletic. I'd be more like what you'd call artistic. Where many boys like to engage in rough and tumble activities, I tended to gravitate more toward board games, reading, and solving puzzles. Now, that's not to say I didn't enjoy sandlot baseball or engage in swimming and tennis. But when it came to intense body contact, that just wasn't me. It only took playing pickup football to realize that my body doesn't appreciate that abuse. Same thing with basketball. It was rougher than I ever imagined watching it played on the courts at school. It would not surprise you, probably, to learn that I excelled in the choir and band programs. It was much easier to stand beside the football field or basketball gym with the pep band supporting the team. And screaming, "Hit 'em hard!" and "Kill 'em, team!" just as long as I was not the one having to engage in the physical devastation that was necessary to win the games. My statement about avoiding physical contact might cause my parents to object here and remind me that I routinely got into fist fights with my younger brother in our early years. My parents got so tired of pulling us apart that they bought a set of boxing gloves and said that if they ever caught us fighting again without those gloves on, there would be hell to pay. We never fought again. Lesson learned. All through school, I remained artistic. By the ninth grade, I was 5'11", weighing 110 pounds. I was so skinny that if the wind blew on school mornings, I'd end up right back in the house trying to run out that front door again. My being artistic, tall, and skinny led to bullying, which at times became almost unbearable. I tried to block out the names I was called and avoided my locker often due to close quarter intimidation, but managed to effectively and eventually create in my mind a world where I not only survived, but thrived. Fortunately, I had a pretty good mind, and unlike a lot of my classmates, seemed to be able to remember the greatest part of what I had read, which came handy at test time. But it also led to bullies trying to mine my knowledge for their gain. I was told by them that I had to let them copy off me on multiple choice and true-false tests or else. Now, you may say, well, why not just tell the teachers or the principal? Yeah, right. I've got to go to this school. On tests, I'd let them see over my shoulder or across the aisle. And after they saw what they wanted, I'd go back and change the crucial answers. Those guys never did figure out why I got A's and they got C's. I was no ladies' man, and I knew it. All I ever wanted was to just be friends with the guys and the girls. One girl I enjoyed knowing was in my Spanish class, who happened to be 2 years ahead of me and going steady with a Hulk on the football team, Big Fred. Now, Stacy didn't really care about making A's. She just wanted to graduate. She wasn't the brightest muchacha, and I would help her with her homework in the library during study hall. Fred's football teammates told him that this wimp of a whiz was sharing time with his honey. And in no time, he had me cornered, telling me that I'd better lay off my woman, or else. A few days later, she asked me why I had been avoiding her. I told her that I'd been busy on some projects I needed to finish. News of our talking got back to Fred, who again caught me between classes and said that it had hit the fan and that I had to meet him by the shack in the woods next to the school, after school. Tommy, you know where I mean you to be, and you better be there. Next class period was banned, and I told Stevie how Big Fred was going to beat me up. I didn't know what to do. Stevie said that he'd go with me and hide behind a tree. I asked, how will that help? He said, well, when Fred is through with you, I'll call the ambulance. In the woods with Stevie behind an oak, I faced Big Fred when he showed up. Well, Tommy, you've been flirting with my girl. Gonna have to teach you a lesson about messing with my squeeze. Then he came at me and grabbed me by the shirt, twisted it, and lifted me somewhat off the ground. At that moment, I raised my right leg as high as I could and brought the heel of my hard-soled shoe swiftly and angrily down onto the back of his knee. He let out a whelp and let me loose. Hitting the ground, I extended my arms in front of me, clasping my fists together, and swung my body in a half circle to the left and thrust my fists into his belly. He fell backwards, hitting the ground with this overwhelming whomp, which I figured later knocked the breath out of him. All I knew was that he was down and vulnerable. I jumped on his chest and started beating his face with my fists, right and left, right and left. Stevie hollered, Tommy, stop, you're gonna kill him. Finally, Stevie snapped me out of it and pulled me off Fred. Stevie and I just sat there for what seemed like an eternity before Big Fred finally came around and lifted himself up onto his elbows. Dazed, he looked around tentatively and blew his nose, seeing more red join that which was already on his Oxford shirt. He finally said, who would ever believe that some beanpole of a pansy like you would ever get the upper hand on me? I didn't say a word. Neither did Stevie. Big Fred stood up. I followed suit. Stevie remained on his ankles. Big Fred, after wiping his face with his shirt tails, said, whatever happened, happened. And not a word about it will ever be spoken. Understand? Because I could take you out right now and you'd be hamburger. You just got the drop on me because I never thought you'd fight back. I'm impressed that you tried, but you know that you'd lose if I came at you. I just looked at him. I knew it was this close to leaving this earth. But after some uncomfortable seconds, I simply stuck out my hand for him to shake. After some tremulous moments, he extended his, and we shook. He held my hand for a few seconds and said, boy, if you're gonna shake hands, you better do it more firmly than that, or you're gonna make an absolute fool of yourself. And he proceeded to give me a lesson in such before leaving Stevie and me, intimidating us into silence. When Stevie's father was soon transferred to another city, Big Fred had one less witness to fret over. Interestingly, for the remainder of the school year, I experienced almost no bullying. Coincidentally, Big Fred would stop me in the halls at times and ask me if anyone was bothering me. I'd say no. Then he'd just nod and walk off. Big Fred graduated at the end of my sophomore year and joined the Army. I really enjoyed my junior and senior years. I even became an Eagle Scout and was named valedictorian by class. I also remember upon receiving my diploma, the superintendent commenting upon my impressive handshake. After graduation ceremonies, I noticed that one of the people waiting to shake my hand was Big Fred, home on leave. He said, "Sometimes we make mistakes. Allow yourself the opportunity to say, 'I'm sorry,' when you get it wrong. I'm very proud of you." He and I both grew in ways we had never expected to. Granted, things don't always work out for the best, but for me, this time it did. Isn't life a puzzle?